You cannot be waiting on people. If you're going to wait on your family members and friends before you get that school and move forward, you will be waiting. God does not give everybody the same vision. Had I waited on my family members and friends back in 1998, it is 2021. I would still be waiting. See, you can't wait on them. I had to go ahead and take off. Look, the rocket done took off and things gonna have to fall off. In order for you to reach your destiny, you're gonna have to let some things go and some things are gonna have to fall off. Some people are gonna have to fall off. You're gonna have to let some people go. You're gonna have to let some things go. You might have to sell a motorcycle, a car, a house. You may have to let something go before God gets ready to bless you and take you to your highest level. In order to do that multiplication, you must reduce it down to its lowest common denominator. He's going to take you low before he takes you high. The bigger the skyscraper, the farther down they got to dig. See, when they dig deep, when you deep down in a hole, that's an indication that God is getting ready to raise you up. See, the Bible says the first shall be last and the last shall be first. He's Alpha and Omega, okay? From beginning to end. And I'm gonna tell y'all something. Y'all gonna have to see your vision. Some of y'all already see the school. Some of y'all didn't even sleep good last night. You hadn't been sleeping because you're pregnant. You're pregnant with that school. You've been thinking about that school. Well, I'm telling you now, it's time to stop thinking. It's time to do. It's time to stop being a hearer of the word. See, it's Sunday, and I know a lot of y'all Christians and read your Bibles from Genesis to Revelation, but it's time to stop thinking. It's time to stop being a hearer of the word. It is time now, 2021, to be a doer of the word. You got to do it. Shouting, the praying is good and all that, but it's time to do. You got faith? Okay, so what? Faith without works is dead. You can have all the faith in the world. See, we can tell if you have faith. We can tell if you believe by your behavior. See, God does not give us a spirit of fear. Some of y'all are scared. You're just scared. You won't jump. Well, if you're scared, stay in the shop. If you're scared, stay in that salon suite. If you're scared, stay on the shore and watch everybody else swim. I remember coming up through life, I'd drive out to the lake and I'd sit in the car on the shore and I'd watch all of them have fun on jet skis and boats, but I was on the shore. It's no fun watching everybody else win. I remember when I drive around on Sundays. Every Sundays, I drive out to the rich neighborhoods with the big old houses, the mansions, you know, 10,000 square feet, 8,000 square feet, swimming pools in the back with the big old monstrous columns in the front. And I drive down these streets and just be looking every Sunday. And as a kid, my mama would take us to those houses and she'd pay $5 for me, my brother, sister, and her. And we'd take our shoes off. That's right. We would take our shoes off and walk around them houses. It's time to stop driving out there looking at houses. It's time to stop walking through there, touring the houses. It is time for us to get these schools so we can start buying those houses, so we can start living in those houses, so we can start hosting parties at those houses, and we can invite our friends, invite our enemies, invite that man that wasn't no good, invite that woman that wasn't no good. No, invite them to the cookout, invite them out here to the swimming pool, to the pool table. You invite them out there. God said your enemies will be your footstools. Now, one thing that if you want revenge, success is the best revenge. So it's time for us to go to this next level. Now, I'm going to share some things with you all today. We're going to talk about how to open this school when you have Coca-Cola money. We got a dream. We got champagne taste. Cavazier. We got an extreme taste. We got that Moet taste. We got a Moet dream. But we got water money, not even Coca-Cola money, water fountain money. What do you do when you have a Moet dream? What do you do when you got a champagne dream, Coca-Cola money, water money? How you gonna birth that baby? How you gonna birth that dream into a fruition? Step one, you gotta have vision. is not based on how much money you got. It's based on how much vision you got. See, it ain't based on how much money you got. It's based on how much vision you have. See, back in 1998, when I got ready to open my school, I knew some people that had several hundred thousand dollars and they were talking about opening a school. See, it's the difference in doing versus talking. Now, I had 20-something thousand dollars, y'all, less than 30,000. They had several hundred thousand and they were talking about opening the school. See, I wasn't talking about it. Doer, you have to do. See, when you have vision, you can see above and beyond where you see. When you have vision, you're not walking and operating by sight. See, a lot of y'all been operating by sight. That's why you where you at right now. That's why you broke right now, because you've been operating with this. You don't operate with this. You don't invest with this, okay? You don't work with this. You work with vision, with vision. You invest with vision. You work with vision. You operate with vision. What do you see? See, everybody does not see the same thing. Even when Moses sent the 12 spies over there to see or that land, all 12 didn't see the same thing. See, Joshua and Caleb, they saw something different. They were operating in the eyes of faith. See, the other 10 spies, they saw fear. We're giants. Those are giants right there. We're grasshoppers. They saw fear. See, they didn't see what Joshua Caleb. So when they came back with the report, them other 10 spies, oh, we can't do it. It's too big. That school is too much. You know, that's a lot of paperwork. That building they talking about, State Board want this. You gotta have a lesson plan, that they want the business plan, that they want the layout. You know, where am I gonna get my students from? Where am I gonna get the equipment? Well, what if no students come? See, all of that fear ain't gonna get you nowhere. If you're gonna operate in fear, this is what I want you to do. I want you to get up and continue to stay behind the chair and work until you die behind this chair. See, you cannot operate in the spirit of fear. God don't even give you no spirit of fear. But I'm gonna tell you something. It was two other spies, Joshua and Caleb. I see some Joshua and Caleb's on here. I see some Joshua's and Caleb's on here. What are Joshua's and Caleb's at? See, they didn't see. They said, oh, we're gonna open this school. Mm-hmm. Oh, I see it. Yeah, the building. We're gonna get out equipment like this. We're gonna have a plumber right here. Ruben's a plumber. We're gonna get the electrician. Yeah, we're gonna get the little chairs in here. That's all right, the chairs small. It don't matter. That's all right, they're gonna laugh at you. Well, the building, it might have a little leak right here, but that's okay. Well, we ain't got no instructors. I'm an instructor. Well, what about the secretary? Well, what about the admissions rep? What about the theory instructor? What about the practical floor instructor? What about the lesson plans? See, Joshua and Caleb, they didn't, while everybody's saying, what about all of that? What if it don't work? What if it does? See, they were operating in the spirit of faith. What do you see? See, those people back in 1990, they had 1,000 times more money than I did, but they were operating in fear. See, when you operate in the spirit of fear, someone operating in the spirit of faith in the spiritual will always outdo someone operating in the natural. You can't beat God's giving. I don't care if the world is against you, if God is for you, if God said it's going to be, I don't care if you hanging over that cliff, if God said it was going to be, it's going to be what he said. And a lot of y'all have been operating in fear. That's why you operating below your potential. And you see people, not even in the spirit, even with your own eyes, you see people with less gifts, less talent, less resources doing more than you. And that's with your regular eyes. I ain't even talking about with the spirit, the mind. No, I'm talking about with your regular eyes. And this with your regular eyes. Yes, you see it. How long are you gonna sit there and watch them win? How long are you gonna sit there and let them train the students? And they sitting back like this. with the students out there working. Somebody come in, they pay at the front desk, money goes to the school owner. They ain't even doing no work. Ain't teaching the students, ain't doing nothing, making all this money. Then the student graduates and can't even cut no hair, can't even style no hair, don't even know how to work a Marcel line, don't even know how to work a blow dryer, can't even shampoo, have people all wet. But that's okay, because you gonna train them in your shop. And after you train them and pour into them and bless them and preach to them and inspire them and educate them and enlighten them and empower them and bend over backwards with no Vaseline, they gonna leave. And now you mad with your mouth poked out. Well, you know what you need to do about that? You need to open a school. And your best students, when they graduate, they should be going to work in your shop. You should have the money in a circle. They come to the school. Your best students, put them in your shop. Put them in your shop. That's what you do. Yeah, it should be in a circle. Woods, Janice Jackson, Jill Williams, Kim McGee, KRW and Beauty Melissa. It should be in a circle, Paris, Rebecca, Red the Barber, Sandy. You should have that school. Shalette Wright, Toby, get that school. It should be in a circle. They come to your school, you train them, then they go work in your shop. Or partner with them on the shop. Your best students. Lisa Burks. That's what you do. That's what you do, Sharon Baden. Yeah, Coretta. That's what you do. Yeah, Deanna Folks. That's what you do. Look, you giving them everything you got. What do you do when a barber or stylist comes in your shop, Heaven? I'm Courtney. And you give them all you got. Everything you done learned, you bend over backwards. You bent over backwards, and then they leave. And you gave them all you had, and you walk home. It's okay. That's an indication it's time for you to open the school. That's an indication it's time for you to go to the next level. See, a lot of times we won't move when God tells us. And for you all out there that will not obey God, for you all out there that have disobeyed God and you're disobeying him, let me tell you something. He gonna light a little fire up under you. He's gonna inflict some pain. See, he knows that pain brings change. And if you don't change, if you don't get this school, he's gonna inflict some more pain at that shop. Yes, he is. That's what's gonna happen. So I'm telling you, it's time to move to the next level. What you gonna do, John? What you gonna do? How long are y'all gonna keep looking? Ain't no sense of y'all looking at me. I had a school 19 years. Been in this business 23 years. Long time. All my friends are broke down. Bodies tore up from the floor up. Hands, copper tunnel, back messed up, neck, Velcro veins. I'm gonna tell you something. How long are you gonna stay in that shop? Look, it will beat you up. Look, it's like playing in the NFL. After you done played in the league for so long, your body's broken up. After you done worked in the shop so long, your body's gonna be broke up. For you all that's been doing it 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40, you're a soldier. I take my hat off to you. I could not do it. Early on, I'm gonna tell y'all something. In 1990, when I was in barber school, I cut over 30 heads the day before Easter. And I watched that man make all that money with all of us on the clinic floor cutting. It clicked in my head at that time, and I was 18 years old. It clicked in my head, one day I'm gonna get me a barber school. We never went in the classroom. We never cracked open the book. I mean, has it hit you in the head yet? It ain't rang a bell in your head. It should have. What are you waiting on? And some of y'all waiting? Procrastination is not of God. Procrastination is not. Look, if you're not ready, continue to do what you're doing. I came to talk to some school owners. That's who I came to talk to. Not the people that want to work in the shop, behind the chair. I have nothing against y'all. I'm a barber till the day that I die. Look, I keep my license in my pocket. My barber license. I got the little barber license. You know, the little bitty one that they give you. I keep it in here. It's in my wallet somewhere. I keep that thing in here. I surely do. But how long y'all gonna do it? And if you don't have a lot of money, that's okay. Cause I'm gonna show y'all how to do it. Cause they said it couldn't be done. 23 years ago, They said it could not be done. I don't care what they told you. I don't care. Look, I don't care what they told you, Toby. I don't care what they told you, Rebecca. I don't care what they told you, Sandy. What did God tell you? See, you got to watch who you listen to. You got to watch who you listen to. You will let somebody talk you out of your dreams. You will let somebody talk you out of your vision. You will let somebody talk you out of breaking the generational curse of poverty in your family. You will let somebody talk you out of your house, talk you out of that car, talk you out of all them designer bags, talk you out of traveling, talk you out of buying clothes, talk you out of everything. How you gonna let a fool talk you out of that? Y'all gotta watch who you listen to, because I'm telling you, I see some eagles on here, Sybil, Stephanie, y'all are eagles. Eagles don't listen to ducks. Look, as bad as a Rottweiler is and a pit bull, a lion will never listen to a pit bull or a Rottweiler. No, they don't. You're a five-star general. A general does not listen to a soldier. Quit listening to these people. Who told you couldn't open a school? Who told you that? Did God tell you that? Who told you that was too much for you? Who told you that was too much paperwork? Look, when I opened a school in 1998, I never worked out of school. I hadn't even cracked open a lesson plan. Didn't even know what a lesson plan was. Got my instructor's license May of 1998. May 28th, 1998, I opened my school. And y'all had a lot of students. I came out that gate so hard on them, Sandy. I came out that gate hard, Red. I busted out in the eyes. What people saw, they saw zero students in the physical. But in my mind, I had 100 students. And I'm walking around the school. God, is that it? You said you was going to give me 200 students, God. You got me 100. I need more than that. See, you got to preach rain in the drought. Oh, you don't need to be walking around with your eyes, with what you see. Oh, ain't no students in here. I'm going to have to shut down. See, you can't listen to what them other people are saying, because see, them other people are using their sight. They looking in the window. They laughing, pointing their chin. Oh, you're going to have to shut down. That ninja, he ain't got no students. He done left that shop and done opened that school. He crazy. That ninja's crazy. See, you got to do some things that people say you're crazy. If you tell somebody your dream, if they don't laugh in your face and tell you you're crazy, you're dreaming too small. I told people what I was going to do. They laughed in my face. I knew I was on the right track, and I'm preaching. See, you must preach rain in the drought. In the drought, greatness is done in the midst of the drought. See, the drought is a blessing, because that's the time for preparation, to catch your breath, to get back, to take a break, a chill pill. Greatness is done in the midst of the drought. See, a lot of y'all operating like the 10 spies, what you see. But I see some Joshuas and some Calebs operating in the spirit of faith. See, and then we got to put some work in. Faith without works is dead. A lot of y'all don't expect nothing. Some of y'all on here right now don't expect nothing. Some of y'all on here right now ain't going to do nothing. Whether you jump or not, I don't care. Whether you jump or not, my life is not going to change. My lifestyle is not going to change. This program is not for me. This program is for you, because this program takes a lot of my time. And for all of y'all thinking about getting the gold program, if you're not serious, I don't want you in it, because I don't want you wasting my time, and I surely don't want to waste your time, because I take this program very seriously. This program has broke generational curses in my family. It has retired my mama. She's 76. She's been retired for 15 years. It has prolonged her life. Yes, it has. From less stress, less work. Yeah, she had to get a rotator cuff change because she worked so hard till she was 62. And she did another rotator cuff change. She does replace, whatever you call it. But she don't want to get that one. She said, nope, I am not going to do it. I don't want to go through that again. I said, okay. So I take this serious. I don't take this lightly. This program is for you all. I remember back in 1998, 26 years old, I opened that school. Without the program, I wouldn't be where I am today. Without Miss Velma, I wouldn't be where I am today. Without her giving me a payment plan, letting me put a down payment and make monthly payments, I wouldn't be where I am. And my mentor said, pay it forward. So opportunities are here. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are fruit. See, The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. A lot of people don't want to work. You want to go to heaven, but you don't want to die. You want to reap a harvest. You want to pick fruit, but you don't want to plant the seed. And when God gives it to you, you look at it and your mouth is poked out. Is that it, God? You gave me this acorn. You said you was going to give me a forest full of oak trees. And you look at that acorn and you throw it away. And you don't realize, fool, you done threw your whole forest away. You threw the whole forest of oak trees away. See, when God gives it to you, he going to give it to you in seed form. And you got to plant that seed. You got to till that ground. Put it in fertile ground. And you got to water it. You got to work. And even if you don't see nothing, don't operate with what you see, because your eyes will trick you. It is a trick from the enemy. You plant that seed, you water it. I don't see nothing. It ain't meant for you to see right now. You just continue to do God's work. And if you continue to do it, God, I don't see nothing in the natural, but I'm operating in the spiritual. Going home, laying out, no students. Get back up and going back to that school. And I had a morning class and a night class. Night class ended at 10 at night. Morning class started at 8, and I'd go to that school. Just like when he said that the rain was going to come. Go get up again. Get back up and go back down there. You said it was going to rain, God. You told me it was going to rain. See, God's word will not return void. If God tells you it's going to be, it's going to be. I can tell you this shirt is white, and y'all see it's black. If God said this shirt is white, it will return white. Whatever God said is going to be. Don't listen to what other people are saying. They operating with what they see. So I'm looking up. Go look again. You said it was going to rain. You said I was going to have students. It ain't none here. Go look again. And the seventh time, one little student came. I see a cloud the size of a man's hand. And see, God said it was going to rain. It was going to flood. It was going to pour. But it didn't look like it. See, what do you do when it don't look like it? But God told you what it was going to be. You keep on going. You keep on moving forward. You press toward tomorrow. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care. You press toward tomorrow. I don't care what they're telling you. They operating with their eyes based on what they see. They'll see it later on. And nobody believed in it. They all believe it now. They all believe it. They was operating with their eyes. You must press toward the mark, though the sources may seem unlikely. See, you got to walk by faith and not by sight. You got to invest by faith and not by sight. You got to work by faith and not by sight. It's like losing weight. Continue to go. If you continue and press toward the mark and be faithful, consistent, and persistent, you'll get there. You'll win if you don't quit. You could dig your way out of Alcatraz with a spoon if you don't quit. You got to stay focused and press toward the mark. Doesn't matter how you start. I don't care how you start. Ask T.D. Jakes, 10 members in a storefront church with one suit. His nickname wasn't T.D. Jakes. It was One Suit Jakes. I know that because he's my mentor, and I was talking to him face to face like this. And he's telling me this 21 years ago. I'm sitting there listening to him just like this. We're having a conversation. Said, Chin, it didn't start out like this. And we had a dome down in St. Petersburg, Florida, with about 20,000 plus people up in this dome. And we're in the back talking in a private room. And he said, I remember when they called me One Suit Jakes, because he had one suit. One suit, Dominique. And when he prayed, he couldn't get out on his knees because he had holes on the bottom of his shoes. And the car, they had to put a mat down on the floorboard because there was a hole in the floorboard of the car. Cars got repossessed. Him and his wife looked at each other. He said his wife, Sister Sarita, looked at him and said, the devil is alive. They didn't go try to hide the cars around back over friend's house. He's telling me all these stories. Started with 10 members. 10 members in a storefront church in the hills of West Virginia. And he would travel up the hills in his car and it'd break down. He's going to preach his brains out for $50 and he got $100 in bills. He going to preach at other churches just so he could get some money to pay the people at his church. And the first offering, heaven, the first offering was $19.25, John and Kim, and $3.25, Kim, was from the bake sale. And it wasn't vegan, Kim. And his mama cooking fried fish in the back. the baptism bowl, he said the pool was lopsided and leaking. When he first went into the church to rent the building, he fell through the floor. And this is a true story, him telling me this, that the floor was messed up and weak. But he had a vision. Other people saw operating in sight. He didn't even have an air conditioner or heat. And his mentor, Bishop Watkins. For y'all to watch Bishop Jakes and y'all go to the conferences, you'll see an old man with a gray beard and these suits that look like a pimp. Bishop Watkins, that's his preacher, his bishop. That man believed in him. See, God will always send somebody your way. He will always send somebody your way to lead you and guide you if you call on him. He may not come when you want, but he's always right on time. And his anniversary, Bishop Watkins bought him an air conditioner, central heat and air. Nobody else believed in Bishop Jakes. And he brought his whole church down. And Bishop Jakes said him and his wife, they cooked all night long. They barbecued all night long, ribs and everything. And they put the bread, Kim, Jill, Sandy, they put the bread in sandwich bags so it wouldn't get soggy with the barbecue sauce. And it was Appreciation Day, Pastor's Appreciation Day. And Bishop Jake said him and his wife walked down the aisle. He was like this, and he was all proud. And they didn't know that he had worked all night. They didn't know that. And he got up in the pulpit, and he said, Bishop Watkins whispered in his ear. He said, Bishop Jakes, you still got barbecue sauce under your nails. And they both started laughing. The church didn't know what they was laughing about. But he had a vision, had a vision. And you can't forget where you come from, because I'm wondering, where is this man? Who is he? And Bishop Jakes is telling me this story, and I got to meet Bishop Watkins. And then when at the Woman Die Loose in Atlanta, in that dome, you're talking about 70,000 to 80,000 people in Woman Die Loose. Woman Die Loose started from a Bible study. The first Woman Die Loose wasn't nothing but a handful of people. Now it's 80,000 people. He didn't stay at a hotel. After he preached and everything at the dome, and I'm sitting on the front row listening, and we left. It was looked like the president had left. We all in these big old black trucks, the two men with the motorcycles, the police driving and everything. And I'm in the back of the truck. Where are we going? And we gone through Atlanta and the hills and up Dunwoody. These big old gates open up, and we go up this big winding road, and I'm looking. And then this big monstrous mansion. That's where they stayed. And everybody was there just fellowshipping. And I'm telling you this story not to impress you, but to impress upon you. You don't know, if you honor God and do his will, you don't know where he's gonna take you. He will take you to places you can't even fathom, you can't even imagine. Then his birthday, back years ago, he said, Chin, I'm having a private birthday party, and get your clothes, your swimming trunks, because you're gonna be gone for a week. I said, where are we going? You meet me in the Bahamas. I go to the Bahamas, I get off this plane, a limousine picks me up, and I'm saying, where am I going? I know I'm going to Bishop Jake's party, birthday party, and these big old wooden gates open up, and we drive on in, and it's called Nygaard Cave. And y'all can Google it, N-Y-G-A-R-D-C-A-Y. And the man that owned it was Peter Nygaard. He's like the Ralph Lauren of Canada. And it was a private island. I don't even know why I'm sharing this with y'all. I'm sharing this because you don't know what God's gonna take you. If you just do what you're supposed to do. That private island had a multi-million dollar yacht, jet skis. It was $43,000 a day to stay there. $43,000 per day. We stayed there a whole week. All these people, Fred Hammond, Noel, Bishop Noel Jones, all of these people there, and I'm just sitting there looking. I'm the youngest person there. And I'm swimming out there in the little ocean and everything, because all the other pastors are a little older than me. So I'm out there having a ball on the jet skis. And I bought him a picture. I ain't shared this story with nobody. I bought Bishop Jakes a picture because I'm thinking, okay, he's having a birthday party. It's private. He's invited me to this party for a whole week. What can I get him? What can you get people with money? I mean, it's hard to buy people stuff that I already have everything. So I'm thinking, I know my friend can paint. I mean, he can paint and make you look like Denzel, Halle Berry, whatever. He painted this picture of him and his wife. And I got this nice, expensive, big old gold brass frame. And I had it shipped over there. And I'm thinking, hey, I'm good. I got him this picture, and nobody gonna be able to top my stuff. I'm all proud and everything, Gillette and red, Jasmine, and they had 24-hour butlers and maids and everything, and we had the table. And that day, his sister, Jacqueline, said, Chin, I want you to meet Bishop Paul Adefarisi. He's from Nigeria. Your dad's from Nigeria. Y'all need to connect. I said, okay. Me and Bishop Paul Adefarisi, we connect. He got a big head. I got a big head. You know how Nigerians got them temples on their head. So we're talking. And he said, what did you get, Bishop Jakes? And I said, I got him this picture. Man, I had this picture custom painted with him and his wife. Man, it's real nice. And I got this gold frame. And, you know, I'm proud and stuff. And do you know that Bishop Paul Adefarisi pulled out a key? I got Bishop Jakes a Bentley. And I'm saying, wow. He said, now don't tell him. No one knows but you. This man done bought him a Bentley. And I'm thinking, wow. And he said, well, you go to Nigeria. You call me. I have guards and everything. That night, because they had flew from Nigeria to London and then to the Bahamas. We at the table. And he done brought, I'm thinking, you know, I wear Creed, Bond number 9, Wall Street, all of that stuff. Clive Christensen. You know that cologne that stay with you. Y'all ladies know what I'm talking about. They done bought some cologne over in London with frankincense and myrrh. It's the purest perfume cologne on earth with gold, real gold chips in it. I ain't never smelled nothing like this. So Bishop is spraying it on him and I'm smelling it. And he said, well, Chin, spray some more. He said, no, because I don't want to waste this cologne. He said, you better get that cologne spray. I sprayed that cologne on me. The next day, I went out in that ocean and swam all day long. That scent stayed on me. I'm sharing this with you all. Had he not listened to what God told him in the hills of West Virginia, had he not got that church, that hole in the wall, and he had 10 members. And when Bishop told me the 10 members, he said, Chin, I had 10 members on a good Sunday. I mean, an Easter Sunday, counting the pregnant women and family members. 10 members. See, you got to have vision. You got to have vision. You got to do what God says. And then he had another part at his house. And I don't know if y'all heard of Heinz Ketchup, the Hunt brothers or whatever, that Hunt's Ketchup, the billionaires. He lived in that neighborhood too. I went to that, they had an African party. I wore my little African dashikis because I had some. And I'm thinking, I'm really big. I go in there, they got lions and tigers and panthers, real ones at this party, real ones. And I'm looking at all these celebrities, everybody. I'm thinking, wow. And I'm looking at his house and I'm looking in the garage and all I could think about was when his cars got repoed and his wife looked at him and said, the devil is a liar. See, you gotta have people in your life and on your team that speak life into you, speak positive into you. When you down, they bring you up. No matter what, they always are speaking life. You're gonna have to let people go that's negative. It could be family members, friends. Y'all gonna have to let some folk go if you're gonna go on this journey. If you're gonna go on this journey, And you got to get around people that push you, that push you. And then they had a conference up there. This is some years back. And I'm at the Potter's house, sitting on the front row, center, listening to Bishop Jakes preach. All the celebrities there because it was a conference they had. And then that Sunday, everybody came. And I'm thinking, I'm planting my seed. I'm thinking I'm doing something, y'all. Let me tell y'all this. And then we're going to move on. I'm thinking I'm doing something. Tyler Perry got up there and wrote a check for $1 million. Shut the place down. Wrote it for $1 million like it wasn't nothing. Sold his seed. Shut it down. But I'm sharing this with you. You know the story of Tyler Perry. Had he not been obedient, he was on his last leg. That last play that he did, he had tapped out. He had tapped out. The darkest hour was just before daylight. I just wanted to share this with y'all. I don't even know if I should even go ahead with the presentation because y'all just got to have faith. Y'all got to have belief. You not faith in the program and me and in me. No, you got to believe in yourself. It ain't that, does the program work? Does Chin know what he's talking about? Does that blueprint work? No, the question is, do you work? Do you believe in yourself? This thing has been proven for the past 23 years. I've seen plenty of people come in, multi-millionaires. Don't ask me, did this work? That's a dumb question. Do you work? Are you willing to get up and do what it takes? Principles, they work for the just and the unjust. That's the question. But I'm gonna share some stuff with you all. I'm gonna go ahead and share. I don't even need to share because it's not about the business plan, the enrollment agreements, the orientation forms, the orientation checklist, the current student survey, employer survey, graduate survey, the registration forms, the ISS, the institutional self-study, the refund calculation policy, the school catalog. I could go on and on and on. All that's there. Are you there? Are you gonna do what you're supposed to do? Don't put it on me. Don't doubt the program. Don't doubt what Miss Velma put down and laid out. Hopefully y'all picking up what I'm putting down. Are you ready? Because if you're not, stay on the shore. If you're not, stay behind the chair. It's not for everybody. No, it's not. Let's get on with this. I'm going to share some stuff with you. That's what I'm going to do. I am going to share something with you. Now, we talked about how to open a school on a shoestring budget when you don't have money. Okay, this was me cutting hair in a shop right where some of y'all at right now. At that time, I was making $5 to $10 a haircut and about $500 or $600 a week. It does not matter how you start. What matters is how you finish. At that point, I said, I'm going to open a school. And they laugh. You can't do that. You're too young. You don't have the money. You don't have the knowledge. You don't have the experience. You don't have nothing. You can't even cut straight hair. You don't know how to shampoo. You don't know how to condition. You don't know how to do a relaxer. You don't know how to do a facial. You don't know how to do long hair. You don't know how to do the wigs. You don't know how to do the weaves. You don't know how to braid. You don't know how to do nothing. How you gonna do it? See, you can't listen to what they tell you. See, they said I couldn't do all that because they was operating with their eyes, what they saw. But I'm operating in the spirit. See, there's a different realm when you're operating in the spirit realm. And yeah, I did all the hair shows, Ronna Brothers, Proud Lady, IBS, everything, Andy's Wall. But when you go on your journey, God's gonna put some mentors in your life. He's gonna put some people in there to help you along the way. I recommend you feed your spirit every day. Whether you get in the program or not, I don't care. If you don't take nothing from this, this is what you need to take. This will take you through life. Feed your spirit every morning. Feed your spirit and starve your problems. Feed your spirit. Let me tell you something. You gotta feed the prize. Feed your promise and starve your problems. You missed that. Feed your promise, feed the prize, feed your future, and starve your past. Starve your problems. Don't give it your attention if you don't get nothing else. Every morning you get up, feed yourself. Read your Bible, look at a YouTube, a TD Jakes, a Joel Osteen, whatever it is, get you some good gospel music, and feed yourself. Because if you don't, the minute you walk out the door, the devil's coming. Your phone ring, the devil, the DMs, the Facebook, the Clubhouse, the devil's coming. So you got to feed yourself and put on the armor of faith. So you got to put that armor on. So when people talking about you, hey, you go in that ear and out the other ear. If they say so, you need to laugh. You should laugh. Now, I've had a lot of mentors. No man or woman is an island. I've had Bishop Jake, still have Mr. Dudley, still have Miss Velma, had her till last year. She passed to went on to be with the Lord. No man or woman is an island. I don't tell y'all this is my school blueprint. No. Miss Velma started this. She just passed the baton to me. She passed it to me, and I'm going to run like crazy. I am going to run like crazy passing that baton. The relay race is won in the passing of the baton. That's what a relay race is won. And when they pass that baton to you, you run like crazy. I'm running. The baton has been passed to you. What are you going to do with it? You need to break the generational curse of poverty. You need to break the generational curse of unhealthiness. You need to break the generational curse of negativity. You break it, because if you don't, it ain't gonna be broke. God has put you on assignment. He has put you on assignment, Stephanie, Ashley. You're on assignment, Charlotte. You're on assignment, Sharon, Deanna, Kima. God has put you on assignment. I am Courtney. Grandmama, 98 years old, has passed the baton to you. You take that baton and you run. Woods, Jennifer, Jill, he's passed the baton. What you gonna do with it, John, Karen, Marson? The baton is in your hands, Keith. The baton is in your hand, Kim G, Kim McGee, KRW Beauty and Nature. What are you gonna do with it? Mama has gone on to be with the Lord, Marco. She left the baton to you. You take that baton and you do your best. You run hard. Melissa, what you gonna do with it, Paris? Patrick, Rebecca, I know you're going to take that baton and run with it. Sandy, Red the Barber in Ohio, what are you going to do with the baton, Miss Wright? What you going to do with the baton passed to you, Simply Irresistible? I know you're not going to resist the baton. Take the baton, Stephanie, Sybil, Takiyah, you've already taken the baton. Takiyah was at the correctional place, working as a correctional officer, making $29,000 a year. Now she's making $22,550 per student. Albany Beauty Academy, down in Albany, Georgia. Afro-American woman, the baton has been passed to her and she's running like crazy down there. The baton is in your hand, Terrence. Toby, Ruben, I know you got the baton and I see y'all running. I see you running, Lisa Burks, Vernique in Chattown. The baton is in your hand, Yasmin. What y'all gonna do with that baton? Cause the relay race is won in the passing of the baton. And it's time you coming around the curve. You coming around the curve. Your mama, your grandmama, your auntie, your granddaddy, somebody in your family has run a good race and they ran as hard as they could run. See, you gotta take that baton. I don't know what you gonna do with it. I don't know. See, my mama started with that baton a long time ago. She took that baton and did the best that she could do. Powdered eggs, powdered milk, food stamps, big block of government cheese, cream of wheat, oatmeal, beans, rice, potatoes, cooked stuff that spread it because she didn't have the money. But she ran as hard as she could. No insurance on the car, car in the red, car taped up, duct taped up. We got to get in the car like Dukes of Hazzard. But she ran the baton, closed your eyes, went to work, it was so early, it was dark outside. Keep your eyes closed. Came home, it was so late, it was dark outside. She ran that race as fast and hard as she could. And I watched her as a little boy, and she passed that baton to me. You take that baton and you run as hard as you can and fast as you can, and as far as you can. She had that baton. You see that picture right there? She bought a table from Goodwill and put that plastic over it and that green cover and said that was her island. This is no reenactment, y'all. She raised 3 kids by herself. She ran hard. She took us to the movies, cooked popcorn at home and put it in sandwich bags and put Kool-Aid in molasses jars and put it in a big old purse because she didn't have money for that popcorn machine. We look over at the movies or the icy and the milk duds and peanut M&Ms in the big box. Didn't have money for that. She ran hard. Had one suit. Every year I got a suit for Easter. One suit, y'all. One suit. She ran hard. She ran as hard as she could. She didn't have the biggest house, the nicest house. That oven y'all see down at the bottom, that oven was on its last leg. One eye left. One eye still working. God said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor his seed begging bread. I don't care if everything else was broke down on the oven. That one eye kept us going. All she needed was one eye to cook. She passed that baton, and I took that baton. And you gotta run hard, y'all. You gotta run as fast as you can, as hard as you can. I don't care what you've gone through. And when she ran, I said, okay, I'm gonna run hard. And I opened up that school in the hood. Didn't have no money. I had crackheads and drunks. I didn't have a Reuben to do no plumbing. I'd go to Home Depot every day. They knew me by name. I'm buying stuff piece by piece by piece. I ain't even had no truck. Hell, I had trunk open, wood. I put wood in the back window, in one back window, on out to the other back window, taking it to the school. You got to do what you can. People laughing. God said you're faithful over few things. He'll make you rule over many. Didn't have no students. Had to open up in the hood in a raggedy building. They didn't check credit. I had to put newspaper over the windows because I couldn't pay for codes and all of that stuff. I didn't have time for codes to come out there. I couldn't prolong it. I did what I could. I put down on Miss Belma's program. I took my credit card out. It wasn't a lot on there. But I did what I could. And I kept my word. And I made monthly payments. Put the down payment. She gave me everything. If I called on her, she helped me. Then I got a couple of students. They were rejects. They didn't have any money. I let them pay what they could pay. They went out there and lit a fire up under everybody. They set the stage. Doesn't matter how you start, it's how you finish. Wore a suit every day, a shirt and tie, and they laughed at me. Had my pants pulled up. All other dudes in the neighborhood, they laughed and talking. I bet you they're not talking now. Doesn't matter how you start. Don't matter. Had the little desk and chairs. You see them desk and chairs. little kitty chairs. Guys so big, they couldn't even fit in them little desks, them little kindergarten chairs, but that's all I could afford. You gotta do what you can do. I had the chalkboard. You see the green chalkboard and you see those desks. You see that. You gotta do what you can do. Now you can really see it. If you do what you can do, gotta do what you cannot do. Then I got one student. God, I got my 100 students. I'm waiting on my 200. Ain't no sense in moping. You thank God for that. You thank him in the midst of the drought. Got the student? He don't even know how to cut half. I'm cutting the clients. State boy walk in, I'm just doing a demonstration. It doesn't matter how you start. Don't say you don't have the money. You don't have the resources. It's a lie. The devil is a lie. You do what you can do. You don't have to have this big old school. It will come. For those that wait up on the Lord shall renew their strength. You know the passage. You know the story. You know the verse. You wait. You be patient. And you press toward the mark. And you do what you can do. Don't matter what people say. I don't care what you've been through. And he'll send somebody your way to help you. We had booklets. We had to retype all that stuff. Y'all got it made. I done spoiled y'all. You spoiled. You don't have to do nothing but click a button and download it and type your name in and print it out. And it's already NACA's accredited government proof. Y'all ain't got to do all of that stuff. The business plan, some of you too lazy to do the business plan that's already done. There's copy, cut, and paste. Fill in the blank. If you had to type stuff up, you wouldn't even do it. You got to start where you can, and you'll see what happens. And I'm going to show y'all something. That's financial aid. Look closely. Look closely. Those are students' names. That's financial aid right there. That's money the government sends. $22,000, $20,000, $23,000, $19,000, $25,000, $9,000. Go to the next page. Keep going. Keep clicking. You count them numbers up. Numbers don't lie. Real numbers. Keep on going. Keep it going. I remember when it wasn't no students. I remember when they was laughing. Hit the summary. Let them see what the total is. Let them see it. Show it to them. Pause it right there. Look at them numbers. 1.5 still owed. It's God. I wanted y'all to see that. Not to brag or boast, because you need to see it. You need to see what's possible. You got to speak it in the midst of the drought. You see that school right there? 200 and something students, $20,000 a student. You saw the first school. Once you get accredited, it puts you in a total different stratosphere, a total different lane. You become the person. You become the woman. You become the man when you walk in there. You got a different walk, a different look, a different strut. Yes, they will start respecting you. 200 students, you do the math. Got that school over in the richest part of Nashville. Sure did, and kept the school in the hood too. And not only that, opened up other schools. Multiple, the east, the west, the north, the south. God said they'll come from the east, the west, the north, the south. God, they come from everywhere. You can do it. You can do
any
it.
Any barber, stylist, nail tech, beauty professional that wants to change
their life,
wants to up their level, you're tired of working behind the chair and you want to move to the next level and you want to live a lifestyle of family, freedom, time freedom, financial freedom, then I recommend the school blueprint, openyourschool.com. Ms. Velma created this program for beauty professionals just like you and me who want to move to the next level. I have my mom in here, she'll tell you a little bit about it. So how has me opening that school changed your life?
Well, we were living in the neighborhood. It was a pretty nice neighborhood in Nashville. And so after Chen opened the school and had worked a while, he told me he wanted me to retire. And about that time was the time that I was going to be at the age and have the years in. So he was able to convince me to retire. And I did, and he moved. I didn't even know he had this house, but he always said that he wanted to get another house for me and that so that I could retire and just do the things I wanted to do while I was still able to do them. And so since I've been out here in Hendersonville, I've enjoyed a life of something that I never imagined. And I'm enjoying the house, I'm enjoying being with him because he works from home. And I just sort of keep house the best I can, but I'm living a really good retirement life because of him.
Well, I know a lot of y'all want to start creating generational wealth and retire your mom or grandmom or your wife or husband and move to a better place and have financial freedom and time freedom. If you're in the beauty industry,